Hi, I'm Mena Malik Hussain and you're watching The Coffee Table. Today we've got such a fun show. I'm very excited because we've got these two fantastic women who are taking our comfort zones and smashing them in the best possible ways. Joining us today on set is Maria Javed, who is a filmmaker and a writer. And we've got Meher Tareen, who is the publishing editor of Paparazzi magazine. But more relevant to this show, she is also the founder of The Mindful Missy. Hi, guys.
Hi.
Welcome to the show.
Thank you for having
very
us.
Very exciting to have you both.
Thank you.
So excited to be here.
Yes, I'm very excited. I'm like, yay, so many things to talk about. So, Maria, these days, your latest film, Settled, is really making sort of waves on the scene. And it's wonderful. It's such a beautiful film. And you wrote it and you directed it. Mm-hmm. And Meher here produced it.
Yes.
Great, amazing girl power.
Yes.
And now this is the fourth film that you've made.
Yes.
Yes. So how did you get into filmmaking? And these are short films. So just sort of putting it out there, these are short films, which means that they're sort of not longer than, what, 20 minutes?
Yeah.
20 is the longest one.
25. Settled is 25, 26 minutes. But that's the longest film.
So what is Settled about?
Settled, basically, so just to give you a little bit of a background, started off by working in television as an actor, then behind the camera, so on and so forth. And then I very quickly realized that somehow not a lot of stories that are being told on television or in film these days resonate with me on a personal level.
Or any days, really. Like, you know?
Yeah. And I mean, I was very lucky that I started off with somebody like Sarmad Khusar.
Yes.
So he's somebody who still has that, you know, like that heart of gold where he tells the stories that need to be told. Yeah. But I mean, it's literally just him and or one or two other people, right? So, and also I realized that, I mean, that not a lot of female writers or filmmakers are telling stories. And I don't think the stories differ in terms of man's stories, of female stories a lot otherwise. But I feel like the lens with which you view the world, like a woman's lens, has to be slightly different, right? So that's how I got into filmmaking. Yeah. I thought I want to tell my own stories.
Yeah. And your way, you know?
In my own way. And like I was like, you know, I'll tell my own stories, fine.
No one else is doing it, I'll just do it. Which is actually the great, I think that's fantastic, because there's no other way to sort of bring a conversation forward. If you can't just keep waiting for somebody else to sort of magically come and do it. And I feel like sort of we have a sort of cultural predilection for this. Now we always want a hero to kind of rescue us and someone will do it.
But
it's like, no, you be your own hero and be like, I want to see this content and I'm just going to
make it.
I'm just going to sort of start having those conversations. And speaking of conversations, Meher, The Mindful Missy is just fantastic.
Thank you so much.
Aren't you clever? Like, wow. You know, it's like literally sort of, I feel like it's become a platform where I think people are just still, even now, astonished by how warm and welcoming and open a space. What is The Mindful Missy?
So The Mindful Missy was a concept in my head.
Yeah.
And I was trying to explain it to a few people. Mm-hmm. I was, you know, before you start something new, you're always very scared.
Yeah.
And you're trying to explain it and they weren't really getting it. They were like, nee, iska kya matlab? Kya hoga? Phir kya hoga? So one day I decided, you know, I'm just going to start it. This mindful name was like buzzing and I honestly didn't even know what it was properly, but I was like, it's really cool, I should use it.
And mindful, it just sounds like a good thing, you know,
so
to be sort of conscious.
And I was like, mindful what? Mindful. So I wanted to make it a little bit not so serious because that makes me comfortable because I'm like that, you know. So I then came up with The Mindful Missy one late night when all the kids were sleeping.
And then the best time.
Yeah.
It's so peaceful.
That's when I have like those creative, energy
moments.
And the moments and ideas. So it started with, I wanted to start a platform where it came from the realization that social media has become so fake.
Yes.
And I was part of it as well. I mean,
and we all are
your best
in our own ways. And
you're so happy and your kids are perfect and everything is great. Because that's what it was. And to a certain degree still is.
Yes.
But I wanted to use the same platform and kind of show that we can use it for real conversations and tell real stories and talk about things that that actually bother us or we love or we hate. And just kind of drop all the masks that we portray in public. And yes, it was scary being vulnerable and sharing your own story is very scary.
Yeah.
And I had put on masks for so long, I think since forever, since high school maybe. Yeah. So for me, it was very difficult, but also very exciting.
That's a really sort of fine-edged balance. And, you know, like T.S. Eliot says, you know, in he says, you know, you prepare a face to meet the faces that you meet.
Yeah.
And I think that's really wonderful. And it's not just a sort of a local phenomenon now that people are using social media as a vehicle to just open up and be more honest and connect genuinely with people, but all over the world.
Yeah. Yeah.
We see that sort of, like you said, that, you know, mindfulness is trending.
Yes, it is.
But it's not a cliche kind of trend. Like,
I feel
it's really resonating with a lot of people around the world where, you know, we've had that sort of, and we all use social media.
Yeah.
Like, you are an influencer.
Yeah.
You know, you have this wonderful Instagram.
Yeah.
And but you also use it in these really creative and different ways at the same time.
Yeah, but I also feel like Meher is saying, when I started off my Instagram also, I'll be honest, again, I wanted a platform where I could talk openly and freely.
Yeah.
And whoever understood, whoever doesn't understand gets filtered out automatically, right? So that way social media I thought was great, right?
Yeah. And I love the name, by the way, like, no FOMO. And it's like, yes, I don't want any FOMO.
Right, yeah. And that came about because I was like, I want to do a couple of things. So I want to do filmmaking, but I also want to do this and I want to do this. So I was like, I have so much FOMO in life. So I was like, my page should just be called no FOMO.
No FOMO. And it's so funny because, you know, I feel like Instagram is all about FOMO.
Yes,
like your whole story is everything is about, well, I'm here.
Yeah.
You are not.
Yeah. Are you feeling the FOMO?
You didn't get invited to this dinner.
Yeah. It does make you feel bad.
But I also feel like
Lahore, which is so small.
That's, I get really stressed in even now. I'm now following all the accounts that make me feel good and very smart people and psychologists and doctors and amazing people.
Mm.
But my other account, my personal account, I'm still following who I'm following.
Yeah.
And so when I see those Insta stories, I get very stressed.
Yeah.
And I'm like, why am I not traveling? Everyone's traveling except me.
Yeah.
Like, I'm here.
You get very stressed.
No, this happened. The other day, my sister woke up and she's like, have you noticed that everybody is on holiday?
Yeah.
I was like, no, but why are we noticing it? You know, leave it.
Yeah.
It's not our job to notice.
Right. And also, like, I feel with social media, it's so tricky because everything is filtered. So the only things that you see are the things that people want you to see.
Of course. Yeah.
You know,
course.
It's not accidental. It's not.
And
it's carefully curated. It's like, Mina, a museum
even,
of your
even
life.
When you talk about platforms like hers or mine, I'll be honest, like, there are days when you also feel burdened to be smarter than you are, for example, right?
Yeah.
So there's also that trap that that becomes a persona. You understand?
So you have like an online personality
like
now.
Like, talking about your issues also becomes a persona. So you have to be careful to stay real because, like, for example, I've recently experienced this where somebody's like, oh, you know, this issue has happened. What are your views on it? And I'm like, but I'm not a social activist.
Yeah.
And they're like, what do you mean you're not a social activist? I said, but you see, what happens is, again, you're boxing me.
Right? And also the idea that being vocal and having thoughts and opinions on things, it doesn't necessarily make you an activist. It makes you somebody who is vocal and thinking. And we do have opinions on a lot
of
things.
And I'm not saying I understand the world.
Yes.
I am not saying I'm an expert on how the world should be. I'm only saying, this is how I'm feeling.
Yeah.
And that's the only thing I can really communicate without needing like some expertise on anything. Mm. Like, I'm like, okay, I'm sad.
Yeah, like, this is my opinion. This is how I feel.
Yeah, the paparazzi.
Yeah.
I think people have this innate need to box you or label you.
Mm.
And, you know, a lot of times they would try to say, oh, you're a journalist.
Yeah.
Like, no, I'm not a journalist at all. Not pretending to be a journalist.
Mm.
I am a publisher. But they didn't really understand that. Even now, I feel like it is hard. Like you said, there is pressure. Even if you're trying to be as real and authentic as possible to encourage other people to do so, there's some days where I'm so busy with the kids that I can't post. And I do feel bad. I'm like, oh my God, it's been 4 days. I haven't posted anything. So I'll write something like, hi guys, I'm very busy. See you soon.
Yeah. I haven't forgotten.
I'm
not being irresponsible.
So,
and that's also a weird kind of pressure, especially for a platform like the Mindful Missy, where you really sort of, I feel like you've taken Insta stories and turned them into, like, you know, a force
her
for good.
Insta stories.
They're so great.
The other day I met a friend
things.
In Islamabad. Yeah, and we were sitting and he was like, dude, this woman's he's like I'm so hooked. Remember that, like when she starts telling a story,
yeah,
it
yeah.
gets so good. It's he was like my office mein meeting mein na wait kar raha tha. I was like, when's the next part coming? Why is she not talking?
But other than the storytelling, but it's also a place where you curate a lot of really fantastic material from a lot of therapists yeah. who are also on social media. So it's not just sort of truth bombs, but it's also a lot of really thoughtful things.
Yeah. And there's a lot of research. I don't want to post like a half-baked thing. Yeah. 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 And I do want to give different perspectives. So unless it comes together, I don't post it. So when we used to hang out with each other,
we
as in some close friends,
right?
We would always complain about the fact that we don't have people like us, or we don't have connection. We've been friends for 20 years with certain people, but we don't have that connection, or we feel like they don't understand us and we don't understand them. So where are all these people like us? And when I started the platform, I realized that everyone's out there. And we were, I think everyone was also portraying those masks. And when you see an opportunity to connect on a real level, there are so many people out there. So many.
I love that. And I love that we are in this unique position where we have the internet and we can use it as a way to sort of feel less alone in the world. And we're just going to take a very quick break and come back to this fascinating conversation. Stay with us. Hi, welcome back to The Coffee Table. We're talking to Maria Javed and Meher Tareen about their amazing work that they're doing in connections. And fostering conversations where we can be really like open and honest with each other. And it's just very exciting. I find this really, really great. So, Maria, a lot of your films, all of the films, they deal with different aspects of, I would say, sort of normal life. But they're also, and this is something that that both of you did talk about after the screening of Settle that I saw, is that you guys are trying to start talking about the things that are left unsaid.
Yeah.
So, for example, your film Baba Don't Go, which came out in last year, actually. I have my notes, I have my chit. I'm like, 2018, you know, I've got it down. So, it was so beautiful. And
thank you.
Tell us about it. Like, I don't want to be like, I did it, because, you know, literature student. Like, let me tell you now.
So, Baba Don't Go is actually is a film that I really, really like. I'll tell you why. Because when I started my platform, No FOMO, I initially wanted it to be a reverse blog where people send in stories and I put them up. Okay. So, I didn't want it to be a one-way communication. Yeah. I wanted people to own this platform. Mm. So, amongst those emails, initially I used to go through them, there was a letter that a girl wrote for her father.
Yeah.
And that letter was called Baba Don't Go.
Wow.
And it was like a 100 word letter. It was just one paragraph. Mm. And it was sort of written like that, like I would see him do this and he would leave every... And I read that letter and it really broke my heart. Huh. Like it really broke my heart. And I also realized that this could make such a great short film.
Yeah.
And then I wanted to go to film school, and film school had this requirement that you need to make a film which is 5 minutes, and I didn't have a film which was 5 minutes. Mm-hmm. So I thought, why don't I turn this...
They were all so long, you see.
Yeah. So turn this letter into a film, basically. Mm.
So was it challenging if you were used to making films that were longer and now having to condense so much into such a small, into a smaller format? Like, even like I write, so I would imagine it, like with a short story, then you sort of have to sort of bring it down to a paragraph. It's quite tricky.
It was tricky, but in the sense that I'll be honest, like the way I work is that I also work with people who are invested in the same kind of films and the same kind of storytelling. Mm. So I feel like if you have a good team of people that you're working with, including the actors, including people on set, the DOP, so it sort of becomes like a joint effort, so it becomes easier rather than you trying to push an agenda.
Yeah, and sort of try to explain an aesthetic that nobody else is getting in the real world.
So I had lovely people working with me. They sat down, we decided how to do this, blah, blah. So we shot it in one day, over 6 hours. Wow. And it was just like a fun thing to do. Yeah. We had a child artist. I'd never worked with a child actor before, so that was a lot of fun. But it's very weird. It's such a small film, literally like 10 rupee film that I made.
But why 10 rupees?
You know, like in the sense, it was like a really small budget film. Yeah. But it really sort of, it reinforced my faith in the fact that if you have a good story to tell, the garnishing or the, you know, like the...
Everything else is sort of window
everything
dressing.
Is on top. Ha. It is on top.
Yeah.
If you have a good story to tell and you're good performers, people... I had endless messages from people saying, I saw the film and I cried. I saw the film and I cried.
Too. It was very moving.
And I was like...
And I think the most important thing as not a filmmaker, but as an audience... I feel the most important thing is the actors and how you direct them.
Yeah.
And the idea even with Cecil was that we wanted the audience to be moved.
Yeah.
Whether they loved it or hated it or were annoyed by it. The first scene is very uncomfortable. The breakfast scene is very, very uncomfortable and you're fidgeting. Yeah. You know?
Because it's a sort of like you're just sitting there wondering... What's happening here? Like, what's going on? And I think that as audiences, it's also really exciting because we aren't really exposed to short films that much.
No.
And a lot of them get shown at like art festivals and film festivals. And a lot of people don't go to those things.
Yeah.
But here, Settled Is, and here, and like Baba Don't Go Now, coming sort of circling back to it, is about a father who leaves every weekend and goes on a work trip.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not a work trip, you know. He's definitely got another family, somebody else that he's going to.
Yeah.
And it's so beautifully done.
Yeah.
Like every scene, I notice that every scene where they show the wife packing for the husband.
I thought that was really heartbreaking because that was in the letter also.
Very, very.
So the wife is packing the husband's suitcase so that the husband can leave for this weekend of...
Whatever
he's doing, that he's getting really, really dressed up for. And he's taking so long. And you know, when you, in your voiceover, you say that the narrator says, which is Maria, but you know, it's a character, is that he took a long time getting dressed and kept fixing his transplanted hair. And I was just like,
I know. Yeah.
So, and every time the scene changes, they're all wearing different clothes.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, wow. Because that means this is multiple times. Like, it keeps happening.
It's on loop in her memory. So, it's
even when she's hiding under the bed.
Yeah.
And that whole scene.
Yeah.
And the expression is just so moving.
Yeah. There's some continuity jumps on purpose just to show that this happened over, say, like 10 years when she was growing up, right?
And and you can see the mom who just sort of through gritted teeth. And she's sadder and sadder with each moment that you see her in.
Yeah.
Oh.
And, you know, it was really weird for me. I mean, I've never experienced it personally, but when I made the film, the number of women who wrote to me saying that they know that their husband cheats on them, but it's okay because they have kids. And I'm not judging them. I mean, everybody has their own situation. Yeah. But just feeling that feeling, and also to highlight the fact that kids are not stupid.
Yes.
Like parents really need to understand that
kids
they notice things as small as you taking longer to dress up.
Yeah.
They'll notice it.
Yeah.
And they'll notice that how come he has to go every Sunday?
Yeah, you know? Exactly.
So the fact that kids are sensitive and the fact that, you know, so many people live these lives and then they carry this childhood trauma all their lives with them. I mean, it was like a very heartbreaking sort of creative process for me because I also felt really bad. There was a woman who wrote to me and she was like, I still remember, she said, you know, you've made a film on my story.
Yeah.
And I feel like you've exposed my story to the world. And I was like, I'm so sorry. Like, I actually didn't know what to say to her.
Yeah,
so, I mean, it's a...
Because you're like, I'm not trying to sort of monetize anyone's pain or to kind of...
But it's also that people keep it, keep these secrets so darkly hidden, neatly packed, that even if it's someone far off is talking about it, it does sort of stir
something. It resonates
something
and it triggers it.
It does
but mean. Also it's so sort of telling that so many women felt like this was their story.
Yeah.
And this is something that they felt like you were talking about them.
Yeah.
Where you weren't.
Yeah.
But still it's so common and it's...
It is common.
It's so sad. And do you get a lot of people writing to you
as well? Yes, I do get a lot of people asking me
women
for advice.
Mostly?
I do make it very clear that I'm not a therapist.
Yes.
But they do message me for advice and things like that. But then I direct them to other therapists.
Yeah, like professionals.
Professionals, because
and
I'm not a therapist.
Is it mostly women?
It is mostly women, but some men as well.
That's really great. Yeah. That's heartening. Because I feel like, again, it's like one person takes a step and then so many other people... feel emboldened and heartened and yeah. less alone also.
Yeah.
And so, Meher, what drew you to make Settled with Maria?
Maria had made this short film, Inheritance.
Yes.
And I hadn't seen it when I missed the screening. It was a while back and I missed it. I don't know what I was busy with at that time. I was very sad to have missed it because our friends, mutual friends saw it and they were blown away.
Yeah.
So part of when I started the Mindful Missy platform, ekdam, you know, like when you're on pause for like 10 years and then suddenly your mind opens and you're like, wait a minute, you know,
the doors have opened.
Yeah. So when
that's
my mind,
when like everyone is party trained and you're like,
yeah, I really was on pause. I feel like for 10 years and
a lot of women feel like that. Yeah, you know, when your kiddos are really small.
Yeah.
And you have them sort of, you know, because you know you should have them all together.
I don't know. There were many things, but I was definitely on pause for 10 years. And when I feel like my mind kind of expanded and I felt like, you know, I can do anything and the possibilities are endless. And I think it starts with you kind of having mental freedom.
Yeah.
And so when your thoughts change, your life can then change. So once I started believing that, you know what, I can do anything and I can be anyone and, you know, be myself, actually.
And the important thing is that you believed it. Because I feel like a lot of times, I don't know how it is with men, but I definitely feel that with women, we are sort of socialized to always kind of be self-deprecating and it's modest to kind of downplay your achievements and your interests and just be kind of nice.
I feel like you always know who you are, but then with other external circumstances, at least I can speak for myself, what happened with me was that I knew who I was. I always did, but I was too scared, I think. Too scared to be myself.
Yeah, and there's a lot of pressure socially also to be a certain kind of person. Again, you know, malleable, nice, manageable.
Yeah.
Like for women, it's not great.
To be opinionated.
To be difficult.
To be different. To be yourself. Mm. To accept yourself the way you are. Your weight, your look, your life, your personality. I mean, that in itself is like rebellious. So I got in touch with Maria and I remember that she had made this movie Inheritance and I felt like we should screen it, and that's what we did. So when I saw it, I was blown away.
What was it about?
It was about a toxic mother-daughter relationship, but the way she's made it and she's acting in it.
Is that a sort of different layer of vulnerability there also?
Yeah, that's the only reason Inheritance has not been released online. I tell everybody, I wish I hadn't acted in it, I would have released it. You know?
But it was so powerful and so moving and so triggering and all the good stuff. So when we did it and I saw it and there was, we had done a free screening because I wanted to get as many people as there. Yeah. It was the first time we were doing a screening and so we had all kinds of people who just wanted to come and see it from the platform. Mm. So it wasn't like my society friends are not really interested in this stuff. So all these people who had contacted me because I had announced that I am screening.
Yeah. So you also had an audience that was receptive to this and wanted to be challenged by what they were going to see. So they came and saw it and they were just like,
oh. And they were like, and we didn't do any marketing. Yeah. At all. We just announced it on our platforms. Yeah. And at that time, I don't even know how many followers. Maybe I had like 2,000.
So
it wasn't big.
Inheritance did so well that then you guys were like...
And what moved me was not just the movie, but the way the audience was participating.
Ah.
And they could all, like 90% were on the verge of tears. And they were like relieved also because they were like, but this is my story. This is my story with my mom.
Yeah.
The mother wound.
And that to me is so tremendous about the work that both of you do. Is that it... It sort of cuts through all the noise and just hits you straight in the feels. And everybody is just stunned
for a minute.
I think Maria
is really good at that because it's like a serious talent that she has.
Yeah.
Even with Settle. So when we did the screening, I was so impressed by her. And so I was like, Maria, we need to do this. I'm in. Let's do it. We have to do this, girl. So she was like, okay, let's do it.
So we're just going to cut to a very quick break and come back and talk more about Settled. Stay with us. Hi, welcome back to the coffee table. We're having a wonderful conversation that I'm really digging, enjoying myself. Tell me more. So Maria, tell me. Settled has been selected to be shown at the Tasveer Film Festival later on this year.
No, no. In like, it's on the 5th of October. So, I like...
So, yeah, like, you know,
just
now.
Right,
yeah,
around the corner.
Around the corner. Oh, how exciting.
Yes, it is.
That's
very
really
exciting.
That's really great.
Yeah, yeah.
It's so, great. How does that work? Sort of, did you enter it and then they, out of many, many films, chose yours to be one of them? So, well done. Congratulations, both of you. That's exciting. Where is this film festival?
It's in Seattle, in Washington.
International.
Yes.
Nice.
Yes. And
that's really exciting.
Yeah.
And I also feel doubly excited because Settled is a film, like your other films, that is showcasing local talent. Everybody who's worked on it is sort of all from here. You know, it's all very authentic.
Yeah.
You know, and talking about something which I'm sure will resonate all over the world. And it, but particularly with us, and it's about loneliness in marriage.
Yes.
Again, something, you know, it's like the beast with no name, you know?
Yeah,
it's like,
exactly.
It's a thing, and everybody feels, a lot of people feel like that, but you don't even know what it is until somebody makes a film, and you're like, oh, that's what it is.
Yeah, yeah. But I'll be honest, so basically, like when Meher did see Inheritance and all of that, when she was like, I mean, before I moved to Settled, I also feel like, because I'm, she's like that, I'm sure you're like that, creative people are like that, like I believe a lot in like, you know, like energies and things falling into place and people meeting people and
aligning.
You know, and aligning and things coming together. So, I mean, I'd like to give Meher a lot of credit for this because the thing is that, I made a film and, but first of all, Pakistan, mein who watches short films, right? Yeah. There's no audience for it. Then to want to invest money into something, then to have faith in someone and in a platform. So, because a lot of people have platforms and a lot of people want to do things.
Yeah.
But to be fully invested in the concept.
And
is
do all these free screenings also.
Yeah,
like,
I mean,
why aren't you charging you money? Like, you know, there should be something.
Yeah, so this is a constant one. I'm like, Meher, why are we not ticketing this? Yeah. And they said, no, let's keep it free. So you know,
wanted more people to come. And once they see, now the people who have come to our screenings are like, you should charge a lot of money for this. And I'm like, okay, great. I don't want to, I want the audience themselves to be like, you know, you should be charging for this. Once they understand the platform and they understand the format, the short film and then the panel discussion, which is just the best.
Yeah. The panel is really cool.
The panel discussion is really amazing. Fun. And then to interact with the audience, take their questions, take their views. It's just
amazing. And this is great because a lot of creative work, especially in Pakistan, a lot of creative work that's being done and it's different and stuff like the things that you make, you're also sort of training an audience.
Yes.
It's like you're developing an audience to understand this art form as well. And I feel like, well, why not? Yeah. I think that people have been very receptive to it.
Yeah, and I'll be honest, I think we don't give our audiences enough credit.
Yeah.
Because a lot of people these days are not making the best content. They pin it on the audience. They're like, this is what the audience wants, right?
And I'm pretty sure that a lot of people who watch a lot of local TV do crib about this. I mean, everyone
and
is always crying.
Our audience
getting beaten up and it's always just
and then there's this new theme.
Women
that,
being terrible to other women.
Yes. Yeah.
Nobody wants
also to. I mean we've on our screenings for in all my films I've always had people like on Settled also we've had women from all socioeconomic classes from all age groups
which also yesterday, makes the free screenings also an added incentive because you can get all kinds of people to come and see it.
Yeah, yesterday we had women with kids, we had women who were not married, we had women who were we had men who were not married, men who were married, men with kids, so all of that and the fact that they're all receptive to this content and the fact that they all understand it and the fact that they get it, you know, like they understand what the film is about and they appreciate it too.
That's fantastic.
I think we don't give our audiences enough credit. I think they're all intelligent people and they're all craving for good content because they also have exposure now. I mean, you know.
Yeah. And so, content, again, that is, like you said, like the idea is such a simple one. But it's also so meaningful and layered that even in 20, 25 minutes, so much is sort of happening in that
narrative. I think the credit goes to Maria because there are a lot of seasoned, let's say, filmmakers who are not able to achieve that.
Yes.
Recently, I get very excited when a Pakistani movie comes out and I'm all about supporting local cinema. But very, very big names and then such
still,
weak storyline.
And still,
you know,
it's still
great
the
actors,
same old.
Great sets, great locations, great cinematography, great music.
Yeah.
But the main thing is the story.
Yeah, of
and
course.
You have none. So please, I think you need to invest more money in the script. And then think about all the other things. You're getting all that right, but the soul is missing. And that's why I think that Maria is so talented, so much more than she knows. Because she just gets it with like bare minimum, low budget. Like, she just gets it. And she can move an audience in 20 minutes.
Yeah, it's true. And I also feel like viewership is sort of also changing because of platforms like the Mindful Missy, for example. Because, again, and No FOMO, because there are, you guys are out there amongst many other people, like the people that you feature in the covers, in the interviews that you do for the Mindful Missy, like, you know, Bemisal, for example, who is just fantastic.
I love her.
Yeah, love her. Amazing. Oh my God, I wish she'd come on the show, please.
She's so, so funny.
So, like, amazing and gutsy and just fantastic, you know. And she does a lot of body positive work on Instagram.
And accepting yourself and loving yourself.
Beautiful girl, like gorgeous girl.
And it's just, you know, it's a, that kind of, and so it's just really brave. You know, I just, I feel like people say a lot that, oh, you know, you're so confident. But you're like, sometimes you have to like make the confidence happen as well. Every day is not like, whoa, it's so effortless. It's not effortless, you know. But coming back to what I was saying, is that, do you think that audiences are becoming more receptive also because they're thinking more about these things? Like, there's more access to ideas. Like, you know, you, everybody has seen Brené Brown's Vulnerability TikTok by now.
She is so good. Oh,
they've seen Call to Courage on Netflix. They've, you know, you can follow people, you can read, you know, TMM's Insta stories and be like, whoa.
What's happening to me these days is that, again, I was on pause and I feel like I was a robot for 10 years. So everything was kind of shut, including my brain. And now that it's, kind of open, I'm so emotional. Everything is like, I'm feeling everything too much. I don't know if it's too much, but it seems as the contrast to the pause years. And when I saw Brené's talk on vulnerability, I was crying. I was crying so much. Anytime I see, yesterday at the screening of Settle, I was crying. I've seen it a million times, but there were certain things.
You were?
Cool,
which is, that's fantastic, you know, because being vulnerable, and especially I think for Desis, it's so terrifying, you know, that you don't, it's like a sense of privacy is being breached.
And I feel like,
it's also really isolating.
I mean, I've always had this problem that I felt, always felt like I feel too much, you know?
And yeah, like Meher is saying,
I've literally had to guard myself throughout life. Like, okay, stop feeling this much, okay? It's okay. Because I think it's not that I feel too much. I feel like we're all feeling beings. We all feel things.
Yes, and we're all feeling too much.
No, it's not.
It's an invalidation to say that it's too much.
Yeah, but as we were talking at the screening yesterday, Settled Key, and there were a couple of men in the audience, right? So the therapist said,
it was just a couple, not more.
And the therapist said, how come none of the boys are asking questions or saying something, right? Because I can tell that you're feeling a lot of things, but... So we were talking about this yesterday, that as a society, especially for men, but women also, like, we feel like feeling is bad.
And like, then showing that feeling is even worse. Like, because it's so embarrassing. You know, like, you are embarrassing yourself. And you're like, but I'm just feeling. I have feelings, you know.
Right.
And we talk a lot about mental health on the coffee table. And I think the general consensus with a lot of therapists and mental health workers is the same thing. Is that... everybody has feelings, and when they have no place to go, then that is why we, then you're struggling with depression and you're struggling with your mental health and happiness, because what do you do?
And also, like, we were talking about good content. I feel like one of the basic reasons why good content is not coming out is because we're not feeling beings anymore. These people who are writing these stories, they're not feeling anything. You know what I mean? Like, so all creativity really rests in your... feeling heart.
And your vulnerability.
Vulnerability. Or your brokenness. Or your little, you know, rough edges or whatever. The more we try and polish them, and the more we try and stop feeling things and put on mask, and then we're like, where is the good content gone? Of course no good content's gonna come out.
And even, how can you tell an authentic story if you're just coming from a fake place where you're just like, just using the same old tired things? And also, I think at this point, it's important to mention that when you write a script or when you write a story, the author is not the characters.
No.
So just for audiences, putting it out there, If you see Maria in Inheritance, for example,
yeah, that's not her.
That is the character that she is playing, which is separate from the creator of the character. You know, I once wrote a short story about a mom who doesn't bond with her child. Mm-hmm. And people read it and it was published in a journal and then sort of came up to me later and were like, you don't like children? And I'm like, yeah, dude, I have four. I like them. I definitely do. But it's interesting to me to have a character who is struggling with that emotion.
Yeah. And which is, again, like if you have a feeling heart and you feel things, you don't have to be that person to understand their story.
Yeah. And it isn't about empathy.
Like,
I mean,
just for the record, it's not like me and Meher are getting along because, oh, we both got married and then we both got divorced or whatever.
Yeah.
Maybe that too.
Little bit.
But like, for example, when I made just Baba Don't Go, I don't have to be that girl to understand what she
exactly.
goes through.
You don't have to have had a cheating father to be able to relate to something like that.
If we can all inculcate feelings in ourselves and learn how to really harness them and put them to good use, will actually empathy is what you need to tell a good story, right? I genuinely feel that our empathy as a society has
died, or maybe it's kind of dormant. But if you guys, if all of us sort of keep on forcing these conversations and keep on asking questions and keep on sort of pushing people out of their comfort zones, maybe it's a conversation that will sort of, I really feel like it's picking up momentum now.
It is.
I feel like when you are not compassionate with yourself, that's how you view the world and you can't have compassion or empathy for other people.
Yeah.
And I've been there when I was trying to be this hard girl.
Strong, you know.
Very strong and hard. And trying to not feel anything.
Yeah.
It was very hard for me to... when I would see someone else in pain, it was kind of trigger me.
Yeah.
And I would just kind of be like, I don't want to deal with this.
Block it.
And what's wrong with this person? Like, why are they doing this?
Because it's making me feel really wobbly.
Yeah,
You're making me feel stuff.
Yeah.
Stop it!
I am not feeling
it. Put it away!
Yeah. So that is what I think is important. When you start being compassionate with yourself and you start having acceptance and empathy for yourself, then you can be empathetic with other people as well.
Yeah.
So it starts with us.
Yeah. And that's the first step towards building communities that are safer and more inclusive.
Yes.
And places where, I think that fosters creativity as well, because it becomes a place where you can speak your truth and not be scared to do it. And on that uplifting note, thank you so much, guys, for being
on
the show.
Thank you for having us.
This
was
wonderful.
Such
a good time.
This is so much fun.
Really fun.
I'm pretty sure that all of you guys had a fabulous time watching this. Don't forget to like and subscribe if you're watching this on YouTube. We've already mentioned both the Insta handles. Go and follow that. You'll have a great time. And we'll see you again on the coffee table. Bye now.